I first crossed Mario Livio's path when we were both speakers in New York City at a public roundtable on math and beauty. A half a year later, in the snowfields of Notre Dame in Indiana, I found myself again speaking at a conference on beauty and science and art. Once again, Mario Livio appeared on the stage. In both cases, I was struck, as anyone in the audience would have to be struck, by the extraordinary knowledge, clarity, charisma, and wit of Mario Livio, as well as by his reverence for the beauty of the universe. I suspect that many of you assembled here tonight have, like me, crossed paths with Mario Livio, since the public lectures at which he has spoken involve 150 different venues. They include, first and foremost, astronomy and physics institutes. He is, as you know, a senior astrophysicist at the Hubble Space Telescope Science Institute. But his venues regularly cross over to laboratories in the arts and humanities. His lectures, for example, include 8 appearances with the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra. Most recently, he worked on the Hubble Cantata that had its world premiere in May. Mario Livio is the author of over 400 scientific papers. He is also the author of 5 major books, 2 of them New York Times bestsellers, including the one we'll hear about tonight. As you can therefore imagine, there are countless ways one might describe his work. Happily, we have with us tonight an array of people who are themselves intellectual stars and who, by interrogating his new book, will help us to grasp Mario Livio's own substance and style. But here at the outset, I will name just 2 attributes that radiate throughout all his work. The first is his constant attention to the nature of creating, to the way things come into being, to the way things get made. The book we are contemplating tonight looks at mistakes made by Charles Darwin, Lord Kelvin, Linus Pauling, Fred Hoyle, and Albert Einstein, errors in thinking that served as what he calls portals of discovery. Without Darwin's risk-taking or Fred Hoyle's indifference to what other kids in the schoolyard were doing, we might not have had their mistakes, but neither would we have had their world-altering insights. The nature of mental creation is also the subject of his book, Is God a Mathematician?, a book that questions whether mathematics is a human construct or whether instead it is embedded in the deepest mysteries of the physical universe. How can a remote branch of mathematics anticipate by decades or even by centuries phenomena in the physical world that are discovered much later? How can mathematical thinking outpace not just the physical events to which it applies, but the physical evidence that confirms it? As is true of the book we'll be hearing about tonight, in this earlier book, Great Minds of the Past, are the material in which Mario Livio chooses to immerse himself, Archimedes, Galileo, Descartes. And this is again true in his book entitled The Equation That Couldn't Be Solved, and again in the book entitled The Golden Ratio, the other book that was a New York Times bestseller. Acts of mental creation, discovery, and genius are Mario Livio's element. But perhaps more compelling to him than human creation are the processes of creation in the universe, the subjects one finds in his scientific papers: stellar winds, dark energy, the moment when instabilities produce some new thing, or as in the case of supernovae, when something moves towards its death, the formation of planetary nebulae, planet systems and cataclysmic variables, outbursts of classical and recurrent novae, interacting binary stars, galaxy formations and evolutions, spins of white dwarfs and pulsars. The second feature that runs throughout Mario Livio's work is the feature with which I began, his reverence for beauty. His primary canvas is, of course, the sky, celestial displays happening inside and far beyond the Milky Way, spiral galaxy NGE 4603, the trillion stars in M101, the Sombrero galaxy, the Aqua and Orange star cluster, and the large Magellanic Cloud. Even black holes are, by his account, beautiful. Only the accelerating universe, as his fifth book argues, makes him worry that the universe has forgotten its nearly unvarying commitment to aesthetics. Beauty for Mario Livio is not confined to the sky. Paintings, music, the periodic table, equations, rock crystals, flower petals, seashells, all are for him objects of amazement, as is the Y chromosome, with its palindrome of letters that form an identical sequence, whether read forward or backward. This applies to 6 million of its 50 million sequences. Even blunders, as we'll hear tonight, are, if not beautiful, at least, as his title claims, once in a while, deserving of the adjective brilliant. Please join me in welcoming Mario Livio.
Thank you, Professor Sicari, for that wonderful, informative, and beautiful introduction. I want to thank you for bringing to us at the Humanities Center so many interesting issues, ideas, and people. Elaine Sicari has really been one of the center's most stalwart supporters, and it's been a great pleasure working with her, and we'll continue to work with her in the future. Thank you. For those who are not familiar with our 20 questions format, let me just explain very quickly what happens. Of course, there is a game that you all know called 20 Questions, a guessing game. This is not a guessing game, but this is a questioning game. The speaker, Mario Livio, we're delighted to have with us, will make a short presentation. After that, I will ask our panelists to ask one sharp, pithy question each. For the dramatic value of their question, they will not preface it with long justifications. They will ask the question straight. Once they do that, then there will be some discussion, there will be a quick response from Mario Livio himself, after which we will open up the panel, talk amongst themselves, and then for the audience. This is a game, an intellectual game, and for that I think we need some chutzpah here, which is why our speakers will, as I say, put the question first and their explanations later. I want to thank you all for being here with us this evening. It's always a great pleasure to have you. I want to thank the audience. Without you, as I say, we can do nothing, and you've supported this institution bravely, courageously, and often. And I thank you for your presence here. So may I ask Professor Livio to now make his presentation? Would you like to sit there during the presentation? The panelists can move up.
Oh, excellent.
We can sit there during the presentation.
That'll make it easier to see the screen for sure.
Are you going to walk back and forth, or will you be more or less stationary?
I have ADHD, so I walk along.
All right. Well,
so one thing that I learned already is that if you want to be introduced by somebody, choose a good Harvard professor of English and philosophy, because you cannot get a better introduction than this. Elaine said many nice things about me, about half of which are not true. But the book discusses five giant scientists. I just want to tell you a little bit about the book in general, and then I'll speak just about one of them very briefly. So the main idea was that sometimes when science is presented either to the public or to students and so on, it is presented as a success story, as a pure success story, as if it is some sort of a direct march to the truth. And in fact, nothing can be further from the truth. Science progresses in a very zigzag path with lots of blind alleys, false starts, and so on. And I wanted to convey that. The second thing, which is kind of comforting to the lesser scientists among us, is that even the most luminary scientists sometimes do very serious blunders. And I wanted to emphasize that part of it. But more importantly, Blunders is in some sense the way science really progresses in the following sense. To get to really great breakthroughs, you sometimes need, you know, what we call think outside the box. And when you think outside the box in unconventional ways, it means that you take some calculated risks, and there is some chance that you will actually commit a blunder. And this is what happened. So I want to emphasize, and this is why I call the book Brilliant Blunders. I'm not advocating sloppy blunders or careless blunders. I'm talking about great luminaries who, you know, after thinking very hard about things and so on, came up with some ideas. The ideas were always at some level revolutionary, and sometimes they led to blunders. But those blunders eventually led to very interesting things. So this is the general premise. There is another reason why I chose this particular five. Actually, more than one reason. One small reason is I didn't want to go too far back in history. You see, if you go too far back, take Aristotle, for example, then essentially everything he said in physics is wrong. Now, and that's not because Aristotle was stupid. He was a genius, but simply because he went too far back. So I only went to the middle of the 19th century as a result of this. But there is a thread that connects my five scientists, and the thread is through the word evolution. And I mean by that evolution of life on Earth, evolution of the Earth itself, evolution of stars, and evolution of universe as a whole. So the word evolution kind of connects my five people. Let me now use the, you know, maybe 15 minutes or so just to describe one of these five people, and that's Linus Pauling. Linus Pauling was the greatest chemist of his time, for sure, and one of the greatest chemists ever. He's the only person ever to have gotten two Nobel Prizes without sharing them by himself. Now, one was for peace, but one was for chemistry. But he got both of them without sharing. Here is Linus Pauling when he was relatively young, pointing to his model, which was called the alpha helix, which was a model for proteins. Now, as Pauling grew older, he grew older, but the model remained the same, because this was actually a correct model for proteins. And I want first to tell you a little bit about that so that you will understand the greatness of this person. So in 1948, Pauling was starting to think about how to model certain proteins. And he was actually sick in bed in Oxford, and he started drawing these, you know, chemistry diagrams. And he had one thing that was very different from people of his time. The people of his time thought that if they will take an X-ray image, X-ray diffraction image of certain molecules, they could tell the structure. Very briefly speaking, it's basically you shine X-rays on the crystal, and from the way that the X-rays are reflected, you try to determine the structure of that crystal. Now, he actually came to the problem exactly the other way. He said, I'm going to first use structural chemistry, namely everything I know about the molecules and the building blocks of this crystal and so on. I'll try to determine everything I can from that, and then just use the X-ray images as a test on my hypothesis on how the structure should look like. And what he did here in 1948, he basically decided that, you see, this is a carbon and this is a nitrogen. They are together, it's the peptide group. These two, together with the four atoms surrounding it, he decided, he found reasons why he thought they should be in one plane. And then he said, okay, suppose I try to keep all these things in one plane, but then I fold everything else in such a way, you cannot see it very well on the screen here, but he actually folded the paper. And by doing all of that, he came up with this structure, which he called the alpha helix, which, you know, looks very complex. You ask yourself, how can anybody come up with something like this? But he did this, and that thing called hydrogen bond there means when a certain hydrogen atom is shared between two neighboring atoms. So he came up with this model, and he was very, very pleased with this. He thought that this answered everything that was known about the structure of these proteins. However, the X-ray images showed a certain signature that corresponded to 5.1 angstroms. An angstrom is 10 to the minus 8, 100, 1 in 100 millionth of a centimeter. A certain signature is 5.1, and in his structure, the distance between the turns here was 5.4 angstrom. And you might think, well, that looks close enough, you know. I'm not going to worry about that. But he actually did worry about that. And he didn't publish his model for 13 years. For 13 years, he asked his assistant, Robert Corey, to check with X-rays the individual components of each part of the structure. He checked and rechecked the structural things. He hired two other people who tried to see whether there are any other possible structures that correspond to everything and so on. And only after 13 years, he decided to actually publish his model, this alpha helix. And indeed, it turned out at that point that the 5.1 really was, in some sense, an artifact. There were coils within coils which produced an artifact at 5.1 angstrom, but the real distance was, 5.4. So there was a lesson here for him. And the lesson was that his original hunches were really correct. And all the tests and retests only confirmed what he originally felt, you know, was happening here. And, you know, yes, he spent 13 years on this, very, very careful work. But at the end, he came back to his original model. Now, there were two other things that happened at the time. At that point, he turned his attention to the structure of DNA. So in DNA, also in 1948, he made an incredible observation in a talk. You see, DNA is supposed to duplicate itself because that's how, you know, we get heredity and all that. And he said the following. Look, the best way for DNA to work in terms of duplicating itself, if it has two parts, and those two parts are complementary to each other. Because if it has two parts which are complementary to each other, then each of the half of the part can actually serve as a template for the other part, because they precisely complement one another. And he made this observation in 1948. Now, this argues, of course, that the molecule should have two complementary parts. Then there was something else that argued for something with a twofold kind of structure. And this was something that was called the Chargaff rules, after chemist Erwin Chargaff. And that was, you see, the DNA is made of some phosphates, sugars, and some bases. And the bases, there are four of them. They're called A, T, C, and G. Two of them are single-ringed and two are double-ringed. Now, what Chargaff discovered is that if you take any piece of DNA, the number of A's is equal to the number of T's and the number of C's is equal to the number of G's. This also seemed to argue for some sort of a mirroring type symmetry in this molecule. Pauling knew all of that. He knew all of that, and yet, when he came up finally with a model for DNA, it was something like this.
This is Linus Pauling's failed attempt to predict the structure of DNA. The problem with his triple helix model is that the phosphates form the helical core, with the bases pointing outwards. This would be impossible under normal cellular conditions. Each phosphate group is negatively charged, and so many negative charges forced together would repel each other, literally driving the structure apart.
The model that Pauling came up with for DNA had three strands in it, three. It was built completely inside out compared to the correct model, which we knew later. The phosphates were in the middle, the bases were on the outside. And plus, it did not really obey some basic rules of chemistry. You see, the phosphates you saw here were in the middle. They are negatively charged. They would have driven the structure apart. So in order to overcome that, Pauling suggested that some hydrogen bonds hold the whole thing together. But guess what? You know, DNA is, we call this a nucleic acid, which means if you put it in water, it should release hydrogen. If it releases hydrogen, it would release the things that hold it together, according to Pauling. So what happened here? He came with a model, came up with a model, which was, had three strands instead of two, was built inside out, and violated some basic chemistry. This was the world's greatest chemist at the time, coming up with this. How did this happen? Now, do you know for how long Pauling thought about his model for DNA? 1 month. He thought about his model for the alpha helix for 13 years. He published his model for DNA 1 month after he started in earnest working on it. Now, what happened? So one of the things I do in the book is I kind of try to get into the minds of the people who did these blunders and try to understand a little bit, you know, what was it that led to all of this. Now, there are some shortcomings to this so-called psychological analysis. For one thing, the people are all dead. So I cannot really neither ask them anything nor put them into functional MRI machines. But I tried to do the next best thing, namely I tried to talk to all the people who worked with Pauling and are still living. So people like Alex Rich, Jack Dönitz, I talked to Jim Watson about this, you know, and so on. I tried to understand what was going on. So there are a few questions that come to mind. One is, why the rush? Why did he publish in 1 month when the other thing he did 13 years? Why did he forget his own pronouncement about complementarity and about the Chargaff rules, both of which argued for some sort of a double structure and not a triple structure? And what about the rules of basic chemistry? So these are all tough questions, but I just want to give you a little bit of a flavor of what's happening. So why the rush? I'm sorry to say, he was just very competitive. And he didn't know about Watson and Crick, and hardly heard about them. But he knew that both the group at Cambridge and the group in London, Maurice Wilkins on one hand and Lawrence Bragg on the other, had better X-ray images than him of DNA. And these were very serious people. Lawrence Bragg was already a Nobel laureate. Maurice Wilkins was later a Nobel laureate. I mean, there were very serious people working on this. So he rushed. Why the forgetfulness? That's more complicated, and I deal with it at some level. I want to tell you just one small story because, you know, to see that even the greatest scientists, at the end of the day, they're humans. So Pauling just couldn't stand Erwin Chargaff. He was once on a boat trip with him to Europe, and Chargaff was apparently a very intense individual, while Pauling was a sort of laid-back person. And Chargaff kept nagging him about his rules and things and so on. And, you know, Pauling, I think, almost kind of erased from his head all memory of all things related to that. What about basic rules of chemistry? Well, here is the thing. Here, Pauling actually fell victim to his own previous success. From his previous success, he learned that all of his initial hunches turned out to be true. Yes, he did a lot of work following that, but what he thought from the beginning was all true. And he more or less convinced himself that if he can get the basic structure right, yes, he knew, of course, that, you know, it wasn't an acid and so on and this, but he thought that all of these were details which will work themselves out later. But, you know, very often the devil is in those details. For example, he didn't realize that he didn't have correctly the density of DNA, because DNA is a very thirsty molecule. It has lots of water in it, and he didn't know that. That was actually the reason why he had three strands, because he tried to put two and didn't get the density right. So he said, well, I'll put a third one there, and so on. So you really, he succeeded with the alpha helix. He thought he can do it again. And that is often a wrong assumption. Of course, Watson and Crookes are the ones who actually found the structure, and the bases are inside. A connects with T, C with G. This is why their numbers are equal. It's a double helix. Anyone who has been to Cambridge knows where at lunch Francis Crick stood up and announced, "We discovered the secret of life." This is in the Eagle Pub in Cambridge. They put a plaque there that describes the place. It's a very nice place to visit anyhow. It's, first of all, a very popular pub, but also RAF pilots during World War II, they wrote their names on the ceiling there, and you can still see that, and so on. Now, I showed you Pauling, young and old, so I'll show you the two of them also old. Francis Crick, unfortunately, has passed away already. Jim Watson is still alive. I actually met with him about 6 months ago. And of course, they did with that. I want to finish just with this picture because it has several interesting aspects to it about Pauling. This is from a meeting on proteins that Pauling organized at Caltech. There are many reasons why this picture is interesting. First of all, there are lots of Nobel laureates here. Watson and Crick are here, Maurice Wilkins is here, Max Perutz is here, Linus Pauling is here, Lawrence Bragg is here in the white jacket, and so on. So lots of Nobel laureates in this picture. The other thing that strikes you when you look at this picture that there's only one woman, and that's Beatrice Magdoff from the Brooklyn Polytechnic. I hope that any meeting on proteins today looks somewhat different than this picture. And the third thing that caught my attention was that you will notice that all the men wear ties. I go to a scientific meeting today, and you know, Bob and I know very well, we never wear ties at scientific meetings. And here in a scientific meeting, they all wear ties. So I find this amusing. So I'll stop here and
come to the Humanities Center, we dress up.
That's right.
We do.
I say scientific.
And I have a theory about that.
I want to ask the AV people, it's okay if I will take now this microphone off, right? Because I will use this one, right?
Mario Livio, thank you very much for your presentation. Of course, in the humanities, we only go from blunder to blunder. And in between blunders, we always find our epiphanies. So we are very much with you on this one. Thank you. The game begins. I'm going to ask Janet Browne to pose her first question. Janet Browne is Aramont Professor of the History of Science at Harvard. Her books include The Secular Arc, Studies in the History of Biogeography, the two-volume biography of Charles Darwin, Voyaging and the Power of Place, and Darwin's Origin of Species, a biography. Janet is also a very active member of our medical humanities group at the Harvard, at the Humanities Center here. And I thank you, Janet, for all your assistance and help and advice over the years. Lovely to have you here this evening.
Thank you very much. I hope I'm coming through on this. Thank you. And it's wonderful to be able to share an enthusiasm for Darwin with such an eminent author. Thank you very much. We recognize the same pubs in there in Cambridge. My question is quick and sharp. I wondered about all your case studies, except for Darwin, seem to genuinely address a blunder. And I would like to suggest and ask you about that Darwin's case of pangenesis that you explore so thoroughly doesn't work so well for your scheme that it's a good try to resolve a problem. And I want to ask you, my question is, what's the difference between your brilliant blunders and an unfortunate lack of knowledge?
So, thank you very much. So, let me try to explain. So, I hope that the questions need to be crisp, but the answers don't have to be as crisp as that.
Oh, but we don't want soggy answers at
this
stage.
No, not soggy. No.
Straight answers, and then we'll come back to you.
So let me just explain. Darwin didn't know any genetics, and nobody knew genetics at the time. So he thought that the characteristics of the mother and the father get mixed in the offspring just in the way you would mix paints or gin and tonic. That's not his blunder. It's not that he didn't know genetics, because he couldn't know genetics. His blunder was in the fact that he didn't recognize that with that type of theory of heredity, natural selection could never have worked. Because if I have a black cat and a population of 1,000 white cats, then once a black cat mates with a white cat, you would get a gray cat. And when that gray cat mates with another white cat, you do get a paler shade of gray, and so on. So even if black somehow confers some advantage, there was no way that after many generations, the population will turn black. Because black actually disappears after the first generation. So, and Darwin originally didn't recognize this. And of course, the answer at the end came through Mendelian genetics, where he said that the way that the characteristics get mixed, it's not like paints, it's like maybe like shuffling cards. If I have an ace, if I shuffle the cards, I still have an ace. So they don't get destroyed. And then if black gives an advantage, then over generations, indeed the population could turn black.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Anna Henchman, who is Assistant Professor of English at Boston University. Her book, The Starry Sky Within, Astronomy and the Reach of the Mind in Victorian Literature, will be published early next year by Oxford. Anna, thank you very much for being with us. Your question.
Okay. To what extent do you think that the scientists' inexplicit or beliefs or intuitions about what the right solution will look like play a part in the mistakes that you're describing in this book? Because you suggest that, you know, Watson's already committed to a helical structure, while Pauling wasn't even convinced at the time that DNA had a central role in heredity. And the moment that made me really wonder about the question was this passing remark that you make about Fred Hoyle, which is that he, quote, belonged to that small group of scientists capable of investigating two mutually inconsistent theories in parallel. So that statement really suggests that in most cases one must already be committed to a theory in order to investigate it thoroughly.
Yeah, I think that certainly there are biases. There is no question about that there are biases. The good news about science is that biases cannot survive for very, very long. Namely, yes, I can want the theory to be something, but if it's not that, then sooner or later, you know, experiment or observation would prove me wrong. So the biases affect, I think, you know, what we think and what, in the case of Hoyle, the biases really acted in a destructive way eventually, because here was a genius who at the end became so committed to a particular brilliant idea for the time that even in the face of mounting evidence against it, he just didn't give it up. But all the rest of the community did give it up. So that's the good news.
May I just ask you here to draw a distinction between biases and intuitions?
Yes. Well, intuitions, I regard that as maybe a weaker form of biases. I mean, intuition, great scientists have great insights. I'll give you just two examples. Newton and Descartes, both were geniuses, no doubt. Descartes, in many ways, in areas other than physics, was a greater mind than Newton. But somehow in physics, Newton has had this annoying habit of being right all the time. And Descartes actually made many mistakes in physics.
Thank you. Our third questioner is Robert Kirshner, who is the Clowes Professor of Science at Harvard. He's the author of over 200 research papers dealing with supernovae and observational cosmology, and of the award-winning book, The Extravagant Universe, Exploding Stars, Dark Energy, and the Accelerating Cosmos. Thank you so much for being here. We'd love to have your question.
Yes. Well, Mario, you spend a lot of time tracking down the legend about Einstein. Did he say that the cosmological constant was his greatest blunder? And I think you do the best job ever of showing that he never said that.
I believe he never did.
So I'm asking you, why do you print the legend by using that word blunder in the title?
Well, so let me just say, I mean, Einstein understood that everything in the universe attracts everything else, so, and he thought everything should be static, so he added a term into his equations that added a repulsive force to try to make everything static. Now, it turns out it was not a good idea because, I mean, it was a bit like trying to balance a pencil on its tip. You can do it, but it's unstable. But anyhow, he did that. Then Edwin Hubble discovered that, and others discovered that our universe is expanding. Then Einstein said, wait a second, if it's expanding, all that gravity will do, it will slow down the expansion. So I don't need that term. He took it out. Legend has it that he called it his biggest blunder. Now, it just became a little bit of an obsession with me to try to find out, did he ever actually use those words? Not that he did regret having introduced that term. There is no question about that. But has he used those words? And as far as I can tell, he did not. I mean, and the whole story started just with another brilliant physicist, George Gamow, and he's the person who told this story twice, and this is how the legend grew. But because everybody still calls it Einstein's biggest blunders, there have been books written with the title, then I dared include the word blunder in the title.
We can check with the publishers and find out whether that had an aspect to it too.
Yeah.
Our final question comes from Lisa Randall, the Frank B. Baird Jr. Professor of Science at Harvard. She studies theoretical particle physics and cosmology. Her many publications include the books Warp Passages, Unraveling the Mysteries of the Universe's Hidden Dimensions, and Knocking on Heaven's Door, How Physics and Scientific Thinking Illuminate the Universe and the Modern World. Lisa, thank you for being here under trying circumstances this evening, and we'd love to have your question.
So first of all, I want to say it's really a pleasure to meet Mario. We've actually exchanged Twitter tweets, and we're actually in related fields, but that's actually been our form of communication so far. So I'm also really glad that I read this book because it learned quite a bit, and it was really interesting. But I have to say, I think you might be being a little bit harsh on some of these some of the scientists. For example, Pauly, in the example you just gave with Pauly, I mean, if you didn't think someone was going to be writing a book on your mistakes, you really have very little to lose by proposing a model that then might turn out to be right or wrong. If it's right, you go away with great success, and if it's wrong, you've suggested something. And in fact, one of the things that really struck me was that all these mistakes that you talk about, and it's not true just for Darwin, I mean, in the case of Kelvin too, they really didn't know the things that were missing. So in some sense, it's a mistake. In some sense, they didn't know something. But in his case, it was also lack of consistency, which he recognized, and it bothered him. But in all these cases, it wasn't people that made mistakes that then really held things up or held up science, or it wasn't even them correcting their own mistakes. It was really they passed on the baton in some sense. So, you know, it was a case where they would have success, and maybe a failure at the end, and then someone would go off. So I guess my question is in part, when did people really hold things up, and when did they make mistakes that they themselves corrected? But also, it's a more general question of, sorry, this is a many-part question, so you can answer whichever part you want. I realize I'm breaking the rule a little bit. But one of the things that struck me is that when do you learn from these blunders? Most of these are not things that you can necessarily take away a lesson. In fact, one of the most striking blunders, it seemed to me, was the one you didn't mention, which was Rosalind Franklin, by not actually pushing her ideas forward as much as she should have, whereas the other people pushed them too hard. It seemed that she was being so careful that it could have actually held back science had she proceeded. And the third part of the question is just by coincidence, I happen to be interested in the same subject, so I actually ended up getting the science book you have, Astrophysics of Life. And it's just, and I'm wondering where in what people are thinking about today, and these are very speculative issues, could they really learn from some of these so-called blunders?
Yes. So it was a multi-part question, so it's a bit hard to answer everything. But let me address some of the issues you raised. So first of all, the thing you said about Pauling, actually he himself said to his then postdoc, Jack Dönitz, he said, if you have a good idea, publish it. If it will turn out, if it's wrong, then there are many smart people out there and they will find out it's wrong. But if you actually held back and didn't publish it, so he said, so there is no harm. It's just maybe to your own reputation, but that's not a big deal. But if you hold back, then maybe you will be holding back the progress of science, you know, and so on. And that really relates to Rosalind Franklin, who I discuss very well in the book. Of course, we can always speculate on had she lived till the time when Watson and Crick got the Nobel Prize, would they have given it to her or not? Unfortunately, they only can give it to three, and they also decided on Maurice Wilkins. Perhaps she probably deserved it before Maurice Wilkins. She was a very, very careful scientist. She was so careful to the point that it's not just that she wasn't willing to speculate. She was not even willing to work in a mode in which many of us do work, where there is a hypothesis and then we test it. She said, no, the experiment will lead me to the hypothesis. I'm not going to make... So she, for example, refused to say from the start that there is a helix there, which, you know, Francis Crick says, nobody in his right mind at the time thought it was not a helix, and so on. She was not even willing to admit that. She said, I'm going to see what I see, you know, and so on. So she was an ultimate experimentalist, if you like. Madame Curie was a bit like that too, you know, very, not that much respect for theory, but a lot of respect for experiment, and so on. So why did I choose these particular ones? Well, part of the reason they're called brilliant blunders is that they did not hold science back, but rather that you might have thought that they would, but in fact, they all eventually led to breakthroughs. So that's part of the title, you know, Brilliant Blunders.
Thank you very much. We've now done with our questions, and I want to raise an issue which I think came up in a different way in each of these responses. When somebody proposes something which works, we call it the truth. What form of knowledge is a blunder? What kind of truth is a blunder? A blunder is not simply a simple mistake or something negative. It is, as a number of you have said, an effort to try and do something at the boundaries. Is this the right word for it? Is blunder the right word? Let me now come to you at the end of the process.
Okay.
You raised the question of the blunder. What would you say?
Well,
it's
sort of a comic word, right? It's a word that sort of makes it seem like it wasn't so serious and so on. But I think the reason why this sounds legitimate and helpful is because you're only talking about a very small part of science. You're not talking about experimental science. You're only talking about the conceptual part, theoretical ideas. And for theoretical ideas, it's okay to be wrong fairly often. You only have to be right once in a while and people say, ah, yes, that was very good about that triple alpha process. But in experimental science, being wrong even once in a while is extremely bad. And if someone had reported the incorrect spacing for the structure of the helix, that would have been a very bad thing. If someone had said that the supernovae show the universe was slowing down, that would have been a very bad thing. Actually, they did report that, the other group. Anyway, what I'm saying is the kinds of things where you talk about blunders in this sort of genial, kind of comic way are the theoretical ideas. But when it comes to measuring the speed with which neutrinos travel from CERN to Gran Sasso or any other thing, experimental results is not so funny if you're wrong. It's really bad. So there's a class of things.
Not brilliant blunders.
There's a class of things where it's okay, and there's a class of things where it's not okay.
Thank you very much. That's exactly the kind of distinction I was looking for. Lisa, would you like to come in on that?
I would, actually, because the idea of right and wrong is actually a little bit foreign in science, even for experimenters. And as Robert knows very well, you have to have an error. You have to say how well you've measured something. So when a measurement is made, if you present a result, it's not just the central value, the result that we all take to be the result, but it's how accurately you believe you know that. And it could be because you didn't do the experiment enough times, or it could be because you don't understand the apparatus yet, or you just don't have the precision yet. So I think what's really incumbent upon experimenters is not necessarily to get the right central value, because often they can't, but to make it clear what's the uncertainty in the result in a way that people can meaningfully go forward. And in the case of the neutrinos, it was an interesting example. There was an incorrect result reporting neutrinos going faster than light. And they themselves, I mean, the experiment was actually split, but they themselves said, we cannot find the source of the error. We believe there probably is an error here. So we're presenting the result we have and putting it out to the people, to scientists, to say, is this even possible? Can you help us figure out where we're going wrong? And I think that's totally legitimate.
Well, they should have wiggled more cables.
Well, in the end, it was embarrassing.
It's always the connectors. You know that.
If you will allow me...
Do you want to come in here?
Yeah, just on these two things a little bit. So I agree at some level with both of you, of course.
But
within the errors.
So who is right and who's wrong?
No, within the errors, he agrees with both of us.
Within the error, they are both right.
Oh, I want it to be more entertaining for them.
No, but it's... here, let me give two examples that, you know, to clarify what the two of them were saying. So there was, about 2 years ago, there was this experiment that claimed that there are bacteria that actually have in their DNA arsenic instead of phosphorus. So that experiment was wrong. The results were wrong, I think this was an example of somewhat sloppy science, I'm sorry to say. It was not a brilliant blunder at all. But even that experiment, which gave rather, you know, a bad answer, actually initiated a number of further investigations, because the result was so shocking that further investigations that actually allowed us a very deep understanding into how these particular bacteria manage to avoid the arsenic, you know, and get the little phosphorus that there is in, you know, and so on. So I think that was one thing. The thing that Lisa talked about is very important, and that's the thing about errors. And Bob knows better than most of one particular such thing that happened in astrophysics for decades, where there were two groups that were trying to determine the rate at which the universe is expanding, and the two groups were getting results that were different by a factor of two, but each one of them was claiming an error of 10%. So one was saying 100 plus or minus 10, and one was saying 50 plus or minus 5, and the problem was, as it turned out, really was not with the values, it was with the error. The error was just very badly estimated. The value, as it turns out, believe it or not, is exactly in the middle of those two. So had each of them said that they can have an error by 50%, you know, or something like this, then they would both have been right at the level of the experiment.
Was that one sigma error or I mean, because technically they were actually
it was
consistent.
A one sigma.
Yeah, right. So technically they were actually consistent within the Earth.
Yeah, but still, but they were
this subject is so hard, we just use one sigma.
They were claiming it, you know, very vehemently. Everybody, you know, say, oh, the other
but they
group
did
is
actually
completely
agree within
wrong,
errors,
and
technically
so on.
Speaking.
So within the errors, yeah, that's right. But had they all actually said, you know, it's 100 plus or minus 25, the other one would say 50 plus or minus 25, and so on, they definitely would have agreed. And that's what it turned out to be.
Thank you. You know, I now want to ask our historian of science, and Anna, who's a literary historian, about how you respond to this whole discourse of blunders or blunderbusses, right, wrong in experimental science, the accuracy of measure, the distinction of errors and value. As a historian of science, how do you read this? Not only these issues, but the language within which it's been represented.
Thank you, Homi. I think the language does suggest some interesting things for those of us on the other side of Oxford Street, for the Harvard of audiences here. The word blunder is a retrospective term. Mm. It isn't something that necessarily occurs to somebody as they are making whatever they're making. It's a judgment, and it is almost always retrospective, in the same way that the word discovery is almost always a retrospective terminology indicating achievement. And so it seems to me perhaps by using that terminology, you're opening the door for a kind of historical story which is awarding good points and bad points. And actually being a little bit presentist about the value of the work that is in here. Yes, I think that's what I'd like to say.
Anna, you deal with narrative and the way in which it actually mediates these sorts of issues. What's your take, both on the discourse we have here, but also on the more general issue of what is a mistake or what is a mistaken moment? Is it simply a retroactive issue, as Janet has said? How do you respond to this set of issues?
Well, I think one of the things I like about the book that I think is useful about it is the way in which you do take mistakes and kind of inconsistencies or not remembering something or refusing to kind of making a decision without collecting without necessarily thinking about all the information. You're giving us a wide range of types of different kinds of mistakes. I think that I felt that there are a number of different stories that are being told, but one of the things that I kept being confused about in terms of the consistency is when we're supposed to. And this is not a question, this is just a general question whenever we're talking about a historical, kind of going over a historical event or a historical discovery, but when should we be looking at individual decision making and sort of one person's, the moment of them thinking, okay, I'm gonna send this article off or I'm gonna announce this publication, or when should we be looking at the scientific community as a whole, the set of events that led to a discovery over the course of a year. And I think sometimes the interest in the psychological decision-making as opposed to the sort of pressures of a scientific community, it makes it a little bit hard to think. It just brings up kind of the question of how we understand history to be pushed forward. Is it by individuals? Is it by a series of events and kind of reactions to each other? And to me, that when you start thinking about it that way, then maybe certain errors don't become as dangerous.
Whose fault is it?
Whose fault? No, it's nobody's fault. I mean, all these people were great geniuses. I mean, but they were human. I mean, Fred Hoyle, for example, whom I did not describe here much, did some incredible amount of work, very, very important work, came up with this extraordinarily elegant idea. You see, we know that the universe is the same everywhere. and the same in every direction. We call this the cosmological principle. And Fred Hoyle said, why not also the same at all times? You know, this is very, very elegant. You know, it's, I wish I would have thought of something like this. So this was the idea of the steady state universe, that the universe never changes. Now, it had with it all kinds of strange occurrences, you know, like, because he knew that the universe is expanding. So how can the universe not change if it's expanding? So he basically had matter to be created within the universe to make up for the fact that it is being diluted. Now, it was created at a very, very low rate, one you couldn't measure, essentially. You know, it was like one atom per century in the volume of the Empire State Building, something like that, okay? But he had that. But people said, yeah, but still, it's crazy. Matter appears out of nothing? And Fred Hoyle used to say, that's crazy? In the Big Bang, all the matter appeared all at once.
Yeah.
I think that's more crazy. You know, his ideas were very, very elegant. The problem was that as evidence started accumulating that the universe is changing, he just refused to accept that. And so it is at that point that you sort of see some fault, you know. He refused to, and because he was as smart as he was, he kept inventing crazy ways of how he could explain the new evidence, you know, and so on.
Can I just go back to a question, to an issue raised by Janet, and something that from the perspective of the humanities is actually quite important, which is this notion of presentism in the process of judgment. Let me ask the crudest question. That's what I'm paid to do here, is to ask crude questions. Is scientific thinking and judgment, whether it's about blunders or not, whether about progress or not, presentist in the sense in which Janet mentioned? Is there something about retroactivity, reflection of the past, rethinking the past? Is that process less important in either the experimental or the theoretical approaches in the scientific medium? What would you say?
Well, you look at the citations in any paper that's published today in the Astrophysical Journal, and most of them will be from the last 5 years, very few from the previous 20 years, and none from earlier than that, because all of that's just too well known to need to be discussed. So I don't know if that means it's presentist. Of course it is. It means that we're really talking about the future. What we're interested in is where the field is going and what we're going to think about, what we're going to think about the issues of today tomorrow. What are we going to think about? So that's beyond presentist. If presentist is bad, we're worse than that. We're futurist. But I can tell you that in the particular case of the accelerating universe, we had this discussion about whether we should publish now or not, whether it was better to get more data. You know, there's a moment where you know it's important and you know it's in the balance whether you have the sufficient evidence or not. And this question that came up earlier of sort of when do you leap for it? When do you go for it? When do you say we have a result? It's partly statistics, but it's also got this other component to it, which is looking ahead because you think this is a discovery. This is important. People are going to care who was first.
Lisa?
Well, I think I'm going to come back to Anna's point, actually, when she was mentioning this fact of people working on different theories at the same time. I think that when science is happening, people are invested in the theory, but that doesn't mean you believe it yet. So there is an idea that as it's going on, it could be a discovery or it could be a blunder. I don't think anyone would call it a blunder, it would be an investigation.
Right.
And so and it is happening in real time, but it doesn't mean that it will be resolved in real time. So you often are waiting for data or you're going to check it with data, but the experiments might not yet have happened. So it is true that it is only in the fullness of time in many cases. I mean, we saw the discovery of the Higgs boson this year. That was 25 years before it happened. So for us, that's a long time. So so I do think that it's constantly being evaluated whether things are consistent, which was, I think, your mistake with Darwin. But I don't think that we decide necessarily right away whether it's right or wrong.
Yeah, another example that's closer to the things that Lisa is doing, you know, is string theory, you know. Our best current attempt to unify all the forces of nature. This has been going on now for a few decades. We still don't have the experimental evidence to say whether, you know, this is a correct or wrong theory, and it may go either way at some point. I mean, it certainly has some beautiful and very attractive features, you know, and so on, but it could still prove to be the wrong direction. In the case that Bob mentioned of the accelerating universe, there was still a question which at some level still exists, which is this acceleration propelled by some form of dark energy that we call that has this repulsive gravity to it? Or is it the case that we actually don't understand gravity very well and we need a new theory of gravity, you know, to explain it?
Janet.
Yes, Homi, I just wanted to address your point in a slightly different way and to say, isn't it quite a little simple that science looks forward? That's what it's about. And historians look backwards. And that's what it's about for us. And I see those as completely complementary. It's not often that we, the historians, can add something to the scientists' debate and vice versa. But we're complementary, I think.
The good thing about people who work in hermeneutics, philology, literature, is that we look back and forth all the time. That's why our interpretations are so dizzying. And when they're good, they're so brilliant, because we're continually looking back and forth. There is this kind of overlap of the past and the present. Anna, do you want to make a contribution? Well, I think in that case, we should open up now. Thank you so much for your patient and encouraging responses to the panel, and I want to take questions. Would you please introduce yourselves before you ask your question? Somebody here. Now you've got to wait till you get the mic before you can speak.
My name is Dan Aukus. I'm a postdoc here in engineering. And my question is that I find in my day-to-day, you know, mini discovery. In my day-to-day mini discoveries, often what I find is that my discoveries are instantaneous. It's like before everything didn't make sense, and after it just clicks, and everything makes sense. And wanting the eureka moment of Archimedes in the bath saying, "Eureka, I found it." You know, that instantaneous switch from I don't understand to I understand. I wonder if some of the scientists wanting to hold on to that insight, even in the face of it being completely wrong, might be the driving force behind, quote unquote, a blunder.
You're saying that you regularly blunder. Right. It's a good way to ask the question.
Yeah, I think that real eureka moments are relatively rare and far between when they come to big things. I think that, yes, on a small scale, you may have a whole series of them, you know, and so on. But when you deal with something like, how to explain the fact that the universe is accelerating or whatever and so on, it's not something that happens, you know, in a second. I mean, Einstein published his theory of general relativity in 1917, but I have in the book actually a copy of a letter that he wrote to astronomer Hale in 1913, where, you know, he was already describing how gravity should affect the way light moves, you know, and so on. So it took him many years. He at first went on the wrong path, and only after he asked Marcel Grossman to help him some with the mathematics and so on, put the symmetries first and so on, he, you know, got onto the correct path and so on. So there are eureka moments. Once he found it, he was convinced it was true. He said, if the experiments show it to be wrong, then it's God's mistake, because the theory is just so beautiful, you know, that it has to be true. So yes, there is a little bit of that and so on. And Archimedes, you know, I don't know, you know, it's a very nice story about Archimedes. I did some research on Archimedes. I mean, I think in the bath, what you're most likely to find is the soap, you know, not much else.
We have another question coming. But before that, would you mind if I just ask the panel one thing? You talk about the beauty of a proof, you know, the beauty of an experiment. I'd love to go down the panel asking you how you define this moment of the beautiful. Would you use the term yourself, beauty?
Oh, I don't know. This is very hard for me, you know. I'm just a humble experimenter, and I just go to the telescope and make the measurements. Well, let's give it a try here. I mean, there are some ideas that are so interesting, and I think Mario's talked about this before in his book about mathematics, where the idea that the mathematics that may have been invented some decades earlier seems like exactly the right tool for understanding something that's at hand. And so when you study general relativity, many people have this flash of excitement where you say, this is really fantastic. These ideas about curvature, which mathematicians were talking about in the 1800s, turn out to be just the tools that you need to make this kind of theory. And you might think, well, that's just because those were the tools they have, and that's why it's made out of that. But in this case, I think not so. And for general relativity, I would say, even for kind of people with very poorly developed aesthetic sense like me, the sense that you're in contact with something really true, that has the ring of truth about it, that's partly the evidence, but partly the structure of it, you know, partly the mathematics of it. So that's a little bit of what you're thinking about, I think.
Anna, you work, you know, you use the word beauty, you're aware of the word beauty in the more aesthetic sense of literary form, mm-hmm. of a certain kind of balance and measure and music. And then, of course, you also work in the sciences. So mm-hmm. how do you relate to what might be beautiful in scientific thinking
I think that for me, one of the things that about an idea that's beautiful seems to me actually to be consistent across the sciences and the humanities, in that it's an idea that someone will give you the world as it has always seemed to you or to society, and then make a slight adjustment that allows you to see it in a kind of radically new way. But to understand it better and to see patterns. And I think that for me that is something that happens in scientific discoveries like the ones discussed in this book, but also in historical or literary or theoretical arguments, that there's a commonality there.
Something you both recognize at the same, and at the same time opens up something very different.
It opens up a new way of looking into, of looking at the world, but that immediately you can feel the sort of simplicity and the way it solves certain problems.
Thank you.
Mario, maybe we should take some more questions.
We will. No, will you answer this one?
Yeah, I tried once to define what a beautiful theory is, and it's very hard. In the same way that in the arts it's hard to define what beauty really is, and actually many of the people in the arts actually even try not to use that word. Mm-hmm. But I try to sort of, in my head, to think, okay, when do I think a theory is beautiful? And I came up then with three elements that I thought were absolutely essential. And, you know, I would be interested to know whether Lisa, for example, agrees with those kinds of elements. And I imagine she does, but she may add to them a few more. And the ones I came up with were one I called simplicity, which was in the sense of reductionism, that you have with one law explaining lots of phenomena. Not to have a different law for every phenomenon. That was one. The second was symmetry, which, you know, all the laws of physics have symmetries in them, and that's because our universe seems to be endowed with these symmetries. Without that, we could not have talked about laws. For example, a symmetry, by the way, it means that it's something that you do something to it and it doesn't change. That's what symmetry means. So, for example, the laws of physics are the same everywhere in the universe, as far as we can tell. If that were not true, what hope would we have had to try to explain the universe? The laws of physics also are the same in every direction you look in the universe. In particle physics that, you know, Lisa works with, you know, there are more subtle symmetries. You exchange two particles, you know, an electron and a neutrino, and the laws remain the same, things like that. So symmetry was the second. And the third was something that we like to call the Copernican principle, which says that we are nothing special. Namely, the theory needs to be such that, you know, humans, any human, whether humans exist or not, you know, the laws, you know, are there and so on. And Darwin's theory actually is a wonderful example of that. Humans are nothing special in Darwin's theory. I mean, you know, Stephen Jay Gould used to say that evolution says that it is like a bush, not like a ladder. You know, humans are not at the top of anything. It's just like a bush that grows in different directions. Humans are in one direction. Other things that exist, coexist with us, evolved in a different direction, but it's not that. So these three elements, I thought, are absolutely necessary for a beautiful theory.
Janet, are you going to argue for complexity, asymmetry, and the human being?
No. May I add something about when Darwin came to his theory of natural selection, we have the most remarkable archival documentation of that moment, so that you also have read this, so I feel free about speaking about it, that you can read with Darwin through his notes on all kinds of books. He was already quite a strong believer in the notion of evolutionary change, hadn't got a mechanism. And in the notebooks, the moment he reads Malthus's Principles of Population and sees a mechanism in this book about population, you can feel him catch his breath. And so actually that is a moment of utter creativity that I think is quite remarkable and fits your model exactly.
Thank you. Lisa.
So I've actually thought about this question because I am asked this a lot. And so one point is that we talked about deciding afterward whether something is a discovery or a blunder. With beauty, that's even more true. In particular, you go through science theories and physics theories, and theories that we think are beautiful today, people thought were ugly when we first wrote them down. And even these beautiful equations of general relativity, as you know, if you look at the solutions to these equations, they're really ugly. And so it's something that we sort of decide after the fact. And we do, and the other thing that I find ironic is that actually I agree with you to some extent about the criteria for a good scientific theory. Although symmetry, I'll argue with a little bit. But those are actually things that are not beautiful. I mean, that's wallpaper, you know, something simple and symmetric and has nothing to do with us. So we call those things beautiful, but I think it is actually what we're looking for in a scientific theory is economy. What you call simplicity, I would say economy, the fact that you're trying to explain as much as you can with as little. And in the case of symmetry, actually what I think is beautiful is when you have these symmetric laws, but you look around at the universe, it's not so symmetric.
Right.
So how do you break these laws in a way that's still economical and still retain some of the original beauty?
Yeah,
and that's
I agree with you. The only small point I'd make that we would not be talking about the breakings of those symmetries if not for the symmetries themselves.
Right. I'm just questioning whether we would call them beautiful.
Right. Yeah. So this is why I said it was a definition more than, not everybody should necessarily feel that.
No, but also the act of breaking is not necessarily the same as the act of constitution. So that I like that point, that in the very breaking, in the brisure of the thing, in the destruction of that thing, there could be a beauty.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Sorry to have kept you waiting.
I think I remember my question.
I should apologize again then.
No, this is all great. I read a paper recently, I think it was from the 50s or something, by a physicist, and he was talking about how going down the hall, I don't know if he was talking about himself or another scientist, a scientist asked another one about the results he got as to whether he had pursued an alternate explanation and how far he pursued it. And the whole point was that whether science is rather than progress is going through a maze and thinking you have the only way out, when in fact there could have been other paths. And that if people had pursued them, there might have been other ways to get to where you are. So I hope I'm kind of clear. But I was wondering whether, so blunders, it seems like blunders are people within the same kind of maze, just kind of getting together and finding the same path through. I just wondered how strong you feel that there's no alternate science to explain it all, I guess is what this guy was talking about.
I think we actually look for alternate, possible alternate explanations. And I gave one example of this business of, you know, that our universe appears to be accelerating, you know, partly to the work that Bob Kirshner and his colleagues have done. And the question that we ask ourselves is, so what is the explanation of that? Is there really this form of dark energy that, you know, is doing that because it has this repulsive force and so on and this? Or do we need to change our theories of gravity? Or there even have been people, this has now kind of died away, but there have even been people who suggested that you can do it with normal general relativity, but it's just that, you know, we live in a somewhat special place where we are. We're in the middle of a center of some sort of a bubble. And, you know, the way you calculate things in general relativity would give you this effect, this apparent effect, and so on. So there have been quite a few attempts to explain things. And, you know, at some point, one wins over others. And at later time, it may be discovered that actually it was the other explanation that actually worked. We have had examples to both ways, by the way, in nature. For example, the way the planet Neptune was discovered was because astronomers saw that there were some deviations in the orbit of Uranus from the laws of Newton. And so then some people, in particular Livio, suggested that there should be another planet that you don't see, and eventually that planet was discovered. So in that case, you didn't have to change the theory. There was something that was not seen before, and you could predict, and it was there. But for example, in the case of special relativity, let's say, there were certain results of experiments, and there were people suggested, oh, there is this substance, ether, that you know, it permeates everything, and that's what explains the results and so on and this. And the answer turned out to be no, you had to change the whole theory. Einstein introduced special relativity. So we had examples where there were things that you didn't see and the theory was correct, and there were examples where there weren't things that you didn't see, you had to change the theory.
Hi, Howard Gardner from the School of Education. I realize you looked at different people, and probably people other than the ones that you wrote about, and I'm interested in what could change people's minds. And I'm going to try to get into the spirit of Homi's pointed question. If you have a luminary, somebody of the Nobel status, like the people you were studying, and you feel that he or she is really on the wrong track, what would be the best way to get them off of that wrong track? Is there any kind of general approach, or is it much too idiosyncratic? Looking at all the people you know, did you find any patterns? I guess that's the question.
Good question. Thank you very much.
So the people I studied behaved differently and reacted differently. Linus Pauling, 2 months after he's published his incorrect model, Watson and Crick came up with their model. And a month later, Pauling admitted that his was the wrong model and that theirs was the correct model. So he absolutely accepted this, went to a scientific conference, and was part of the announcement of their discovery. On the other hand, Lord Kelvin, you know, got the wrong age for the Earth by a factor of about 50. And there was somebody who was his student, Perry, who actually proposed what could have been wrong. And
Kelvin did not accept that till the end of his life. So, you know, different people behave in different ways. In the case of Pauling, you know, you might have thought, oh, so Pauling would accept that on everything. Well, it's not true. You know, all the vitamin C story. You know, late in life, he became obsessed with vitamin C.
Wouldn't you say there's a difference, though, between the situation that Kelvin and Pauli were in? I mean, Pauli's model was clearly correct, incorrect, rather. I mean, it violated, as you said, the laws of chemistry. In the case of Kelvin, I mean, he was stubborn, but there was not proof of convection at that point. There wasn't radioactivity hadn't been discovered. So he was legitimately holding on to the status quo theory until something as radical as those other things
agree with you. But the only thing I would say is that the way Perry always presented it was not that Kelvin was wrong, but that he could have been wrong.
No, he should have entertained the possibility.
And Kelvin did not accept the idea that he could have been wrong.
So I want to just have the panel focus on that question again for a minute. Now, you know, it's easy to say that this might be a quirk of temperament, you know, that some people are more narcissistic or egoistic or whatever. But is there something about the institutionalization of this kind of knowledge that actually makes it difficult for people at a certain, in a certain position to accept that a particular calculation is wrong, which actually then might feed back and, you know, question a whole lot of things? Is there something about the discipline? I mean, this might be a question which is completely wrong, but I still want to know. Is it simply individual, or is there a kind of institutional bias?
Right. Well, Hoyle certainly thought it was it was everybody else who was wrong.
Right.
That everybody else was like a goose in a flock, that everyone else was a sheep following the lead sheep, or whatever that's called. And sometimes, you know, the conventional wisdom is right. And sometimes the iconoclastic person is wrong. And somebody like Hoyle drifted from being a very constructive kind of foil who would say, well, you all think that, but what about this, that, and the other, to somebody who became a broken record, who was, or Burbage even more so, and they were saying, well, you know, you're just a bunch of, fill in the blank, sheep, geese, some kind of comic, you know, following unthinking people. Whereas in fact, they were the ones who, although they'd had some good ideas, were now off in a world where their ideas were not even helpful. And so that's a very tricky boundary to negotiate. You know, when does a helpful iconoclast become a crank? And I think Fred Hoyle crossed that boundary. Wouldn't you say, Mario?
Yes, late in life, he definitely crossed that boundary.
And there's late in life for all of these people. If I would just draw a common denominator, you know, Pauling talking about vitamin C and Hoyle talking about the Archaeopteryx or whatever it's called, you know, the dinosaur thing.
Not Darwin.
And there is
No, Hoyle.
No, yeah, and there is...
No, not Darwin, no.
Yeah. And there is... And I think that there is even... again, I'm not a psychologist, but I think there is some reason to this business of these people doing it late in life, and that's the following. And this Martin Rees, who is a famous astrophysicist, suggested this to me, and I think there is a lot of truth in this, which is the following. You see, if you are somebody like Pauling or like Hoyle, who you have done some incredible science when you were young, you know, and so on, and really got all the recognition and everything and so on. It is difficult for some of these individuals late in life to just go on to do small incremental science. And what they try then to do is they try to venture into areas in which they are not even experts, maybe, trying to think that, oh, they will lead to a new breakthrough, you know, and so on. And in doing so, they make sometimes, unfortunately, fools of themselves.
Because it's amazing to think, you know, that amongst musicians and writers, the late phase can always be the remarkable phase, the late Beethoven, Schubert, Mann, Yeats, you know, these are the great moments of discovery, rediscovery in a way, and departure.
I think what we're missing a little bit is there is a value of people having these alternative points of view. And it's just a question of when it stops having value, which I think was hinted at. Some of the times these are people that were holding on to old ideas, and sometimes there were people holding on or trying to advocate new ideas. And sometimes there's a value to holding. You know, I just had a conversation last night with someone very brilliant who I was explaining dark matter to. And every time I would present one of the arguments why dark matter exists, he would say, what about this and what about this? And occasionally it was something I hadn't thought about. There was an accumulation of enough evidence, he said, okay, this probably won't be true. But there was a real value in questioning each of those things very carefully and seeing whether we are jumping to a conclusion too quickly. And I think sometimes having these people hold out like this, and especially because they are important people, there is a value to that. Before you jump to the new idea, you want to make sure that the old ideas really don't hold up.
No.
Nope.
Speak loudly. One thing.
Would you introduce yourself, please?
Mike Pontrella. One thing we all perhaps would agree about is that the Hubble Space Telescope was not a blunder.
There was a blunder associated with it at the beginning, unfortunately, and it wasn't even a brilliant one.
I was going to say it turned out to be a success.
Correct.
Both alone and in conjunction with other instruments.
Of course.
It's produced so many marvelous images.
You don't have to convince
Mario
me.
Mario is responsible for everything good.
No.
I just wanted to ask, because you're here, even though it's somewhat off point, although not off the point about beauty, if there are any particular images created by the Hubble that you think are the best ones that we should look at online after tonight?
Well, you know, there are very, very many beautiful images by Hubble, but I think the one that everyone should take a look at, no doubt, is the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. This is the deepest image of the universe in visible light. And, you know, it's basically, it looks at a tiny point in the sky. It's basically the area you would see if you look through a drinking straw. And in that tiny area of the sky, every point of light you see, with the exception of one or two, is a whole galaxy with 100 billion stars like the sun. And you see about 10,000 of them in that tiny area of the sky. I think this gives you, if you need to be humble, I mean, that would make you humble. So I would choose that, you know, as one of the most remarkable images that Hubble has produced.
Is it possible that our friends here who are doing the AV can find this image for us? You can't.
No.
I'm from Engineering and Applied Sciences.
Please stand up and introduce yourself.
I'm from Engineering and Applied Sciences. I have also read a statement by Lord Kelvin which said heavier than air flying machines are not possible.
Mm-hmm. You're
so
right.
I think this is probably not the only blunder in terms of what he has.
All of these people made more than one blunder. I just chose to concentrate on one.
Yeah, even the famous ones. But the question I had was, which I think you touched upon, but I don't know whether the thought got completed. Are there any lessons to be learned from this other than saying you ought to be very careful?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I thought I indicated that in my opening remarks. I said, look, sometimes to actually get to the breakthroughs, you need this outside-the-box thinking, which means that, you know, you have to be able to take some calculated risks. In mathematical terms, you know, if you are stuck at some minimum somewhere, sometimes, you know, infinitesimal movements are not going to get you out of there. You need what mathematicians would call finite amplitude perturbation, you know, to get you out of there. So sometimes you need these very bold ideas to get to real breakthroughs. This is not to say that they sometimes
don't come without any blunders. But what I'm saying is that you need sometimes to think in, you know, to have some people think in this way. And yes, sometimes they would blunder, but sometimes it would lead to real breakthroughs. So I think that's the big lesson. Now, you know, from Einstein's mistakes, it's very difficult for the rest of us mortals to learn something because, you know, Einstein could make 7 mistakes along the way and still get the end result right. And very few of us can actually do that. That's how strong his intuition was. But yes, I think that would be the main lesson.
I'm Sarah Fazzi. I'm an undergraduate at Harvard. So my question relates, it's slightly different. It's what do you do if I'm thinking of the story of Galois and the solvability of the quintic, where he was actually right, but the scientific community in general ignored his work and thought he was wrong. So it's kind of like when your society is the one making the blunder and you are the one right, how do you stick to your convictions in that kind of scenario? I mean, he might have been partially a victim of his times. Maybe in a more modern context, his work would not have been ignored in that profound way. But otherwise, if he hadn't persisted and others hadn't tried to rediscover his work, we would have lost his contribution to mathematics.
Well, you know, as you perhaps know, I mean, he's one of my heroes. I wrote a whole chapter about him in The Equation That Couldn't Be Solved.
I actually read your competitor's book, Ian Stewart's Beauty is True. But I asked once you read your book on that.
Galois was an unusual person in many ways. You know, all of us had pretty successful careers, but I think Lisa actually succeeded in doing some things before the age of 20. But I know that I didn't do anything of any value before the age of 20. Galois invented group theory before the age of 20, and he died at 20. In a duel. So he didn't get many years to see the fruits of his work. Mathematics was important to him, but the revolutionary ideas were equally important to him. So I don't know what he was upset about more, you know, not having his ideas accepted during his lifetime or being unable to skate the wall during the three glorious days, to join the fighting. But the story is that eventually his theories were accepted. I mean, you know, and it had he actually lived a normal life, he would have even lived to see that, because it was not 100 years after his death. It was 15 years after his death, and he died at 20. So he would have been just in his mid-30s, you know, when people have rediscovered his things about group theory. So, please.
I think it is a really good point, and I do sometimes wonder. I mean, we do have a scientific community, and we do stuff. And actually, when I was writing my first book, I actually spoke to Jerry Holton, who's sitting behind you, because I had the question with Einstein. I mean, he was working in this patent office and didn't have. I mean, why did his theory? Like, why did anyone pay attention to his theory so quickly? And it turned out that Planck, another major physicist, was in charge of the journal and had published the results. So I think it is a question sometimes of getting it to the right, and getting it to someone who's actually thinking about the same problem. And if you are really working on something that no one else has thought about, it does take a while. But if you get it to someone that's thinking about it and recognizes the solution, then it can happen more quickly.
If we can have the lights off, we'll see the Hubble ultra deep field.
Well, that's kind of a part of it, but it conveys the main point that I was trying to make, basically, that every point of light you see, and by that I mean even this point of light, which you can barely see from where you sit, is a galaxy with 100 billion stars like the sun.
So low-res deep field doesn't quite work.
So it's really pretty amazing. I mean, and you know, you can take this area now and multiply it over the whole sky, and you get a number like 200 billion galaxies in the observable universe. that's really mind-boggling. Yeah.
Well, now I'm getting interested in this beauty question.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Because it's only because you know what that stuff is that this image is beautiful. There are other images that, you know, the pillars and all that sort of stuff that are convey to people something immediate that they understand. Here, you need to know something to find this beautiful. You need to know that those are those galaxies, that you're seeing the same thing at such a large distance that it's just a little point as the things that you see nearby as great big pinwheels or, in fact, the Milky Way that we're living in.
Well,
so you have to bring a lot to this image, and you had to tell us what those things are for, to convey the real meaning.
You're absolutely right, yes.
Otherwise, it's just little dots. Yeah,
what Bob says that, you know, some individual objects like some planetary nebulae, from just a purely aesthetic point of view, I mean, you would find them more aesthetic than points of light like this. And it is really when you understand the meaning behind this that, you know, you really appreciate the beauty of this particular.
I'm getting image. Into this.
But I think what come Mario is saying.
Come more often to the Humanities Center. Well, I think this is the on that wonderful image with your interpretation of it, the acceptance of beauty, the elaboration of history. I think this is the right moment to call this evening to a close. I want to thank you all very much for being here. Of course, Mario Livio for stimulating this wide-ranging discussion, my panelists for coming in with wonderful questions, Elaine Scarry, who introduced this evening with panache, and all of you, please come again and again and again. Thank you.